Let me welcome you to this first New Zealand public lecture for a John Monet Network project, as you can see from the PowerPoints. This NEAR project, which is bringing together experts from Japan, India, China, and Japan to study how the European Union is being understood in the Asian region, and how, in particular, the EU is responding to those crises, however we want to define those crises, and how it's understood in our part of the world. As you can see, there isn't a New Zealand focus other than we are managing the project here, and of course we've added in our perceptions work in the past. But this is a three-year project, and we're at the halfway stage. And so we've had a meeting all day yesterday to look at the academic outputs, the chapters for a joint edited volume that is going to be published at the end of this research project. So it is indeed my delight to have here very eminent scholars from the countries involved. I think you can see their names, but Professor Lee Francis on EU-Asian relations in our region. And we also have in the audience Professor Kim, who is a senior Korean expert. Indeed, Professor Kim and I think Professor Dai were reminiscing last night that they met 34 years ago to start talking about how do we promote EU studies in Asia. So we're greatly indebted to Professor Kim, Professor Dai, and Professor Tanaka, who's a relatively young boy. I think only 27 years collaboration.
Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jason Mei, professor at Korea University. And once again, I'm delivering my sincere gratitude to Chris Martin Poland and the organizer of this conference. And, it's a great pleasure to be in the southern part, the southern hemisphere of the world, and out of the Pyeongchang Winter Olympic Games, which is minus, but temperature used to be minus 5 to 10 degrees, and happy to be in summer here. All right, today I will briefly mention about the EU crisis in EU and the responses from Korea. And we actually have two representatives from Korea. So, a slight division of labor is, as a political scientist, I will try to cover more IR and political perspective, and Professor Park Sung-hoon as a renowned economist, he will cover the economic aspect of the EU crisis and also the Korean economic responses. Okay, so first, when EU crisis, okay, what kind of crisis? And I think crises are not a new concept for the European Union, because European Union itself has been an offspring of crisis. It came out of the crisis, economic crisis, political crisis. And when we look back the past half century of the evolution of the European Union, constant challenges, constant crisis. EMU, when we go back to the early EMS year, when we look at the creation of European coal and steel community, is all the response toward some kind of political or economic crisis. So I think we don't have to be particularly a lot about the crisis itself, but the thing is, at this moment, what kind of crisis need our special attention and how we are responding to the European crisis? Because nowadays, Europe and Asia and even in New Zealand, well, geographically, there is a distance, but at the same time, we are highly connected, economically, politically connected. So, crisis is just a matter of smaller or bigger crisis, and visible or sometimes invisible crisis. And for Korea is a country Well, that led with crisis, North Korean nuclear crisis, economic crisis. When we look at, when I recall the presidential and prime minister's speech, well, kind of annual speech on the New Year's Day, it oftentimes, and almost without exception, it stuck with the phrase saying that Korean Peninsula is in dire crisis, where the year of 2017, 18, 16, 19, 97, yes, we are in a huge transition challenge. We are under challenges. So crisis, that means a challenge, and challenge means a new opportunity and task to cope with. Okay, so upon those notions of crisis, the recent EU crisis, well, yesterday we had a long discussion what kind of crisis we have to pay attention. And crisis number one was the European financial economic crisis, Eurozone crisis, and the second thing was the Brexit. And also there are a couple of other challenges like the rise of extreme right, refugee issues, and nowadays there's Trump, and kind of the Trump effect, and also the rise of nationalism. Okay. Maybe regarding the Brexit, okay. Korea is, well, the effect of Brexit will be mainly on economic domain, but at the same time, it does have political consequences. What kind of European Union will function in international diplomacy and international relations without the UK? And what kind, and well, also together with the economic side, what kind of economic and trade entity UK would be once they finish the ongoing divorce negotiations? So for Korea, interestingly, Korea is one of the top priority country for UK for preferential trade agreement, say, well, namely FTA. So, and the reason is Korea is a decent sized economy, like ranking 12, 13th. It's a pretty large economy. And used to have a quite close relation, for economic relation with the UK. And Korea is a very experienced FTA negotiator. We have far more than a dozen FTA negotiations, and also with the EU, EFTA, and a number of individual countries, including New Zealand. So we have lots of template. We know what to do in a relatively short period of time. So the UK sent a couple of signals to South Korea. Okay. But the thing is, the Korea should know what kind of trade entity the UK would be, what would be UK's position, okay, and what kind of relations UK would set with the EU and EFTA countries. So in a sense, we are waiting, but the issue is rather technical, but both sides are thinking their relations in terms of the trade partner, and that will also determine, whether there will be a substantial minus with the European Union, and how much kind of the trade and financial assets will move from the UK to the European Union side, the continent side. That will be a one factor and one challenge for Korea. The second one is Korea has a huge concern on the peace building on the Korean Peninsula, especially dealing with North Korea. Okay, and the EU. The European Union has long been a supporter of peace building on the Korean Peninsula, and EU has been a major donor to humanitarian aid and major development aid to North Korea. Now, somewhat different from the United States, okay? And the UK is one of the major kind of foreign policy actor in the European Union, what we're considering it is kind of diplomatic weight. And UK was one of few countries that actually possessed the hard power, military, hard military capacity. So EU without UK means the EU with lesser amount of hard military capacity that could be directly involved in crisis management. So EU will be more kind of norm-driven, dialogue-driven, preventive diplomacy, and also post-crisis management-driven via the actor, probably. How that will affect the EU's policy toward non-proliferation and the peace building on the Korean Peninsula. That is one big major concern. One recent progress is Korea recently signed a crisis management agreement with the European Union, Korea's first Asian countries that is joining the security pillar of the European Union. So that is a quite meaningful process. So we have all the institutional structure with the European Union. The challenge will be how to deepen and either with or without the UK, what kind of reasonable expectation, political expectation Korea will have for the European Union, and what kind of resources and what kind of momentum we can draw from the Brussels side. So that will be a major political response from Korea regarding the recent changes political and economic changes in the European Union side. Okay, so I will stop my brief introduction here. Thank you very much.